Hello, I'm Dr. Dennis McKenna. As always, I'm joined by Dr. Fred Venditti, our hospital system general director, providing you the update from Albany Medical Center on the coronavirus. Today is Wednesday, May 6th. We have no new numbers from the five counties on the number of cases that have tested positive for COVID-19. We'll provide an update tomorrow if we get new numbers. Inside here in the medical center, we have 54 cases currently being treated for COVID-19. We have 38 that are on a medical or surgical floor. We have 16 in an ICU. We have 7 on a ventilator. Fred, over the last 7 days, we've taken 5 transfers in from regional hospitals, none from downstate. I think this speaks to some of the things that we do here that are different.
We are the referral center for the region, Dennis, so we get patients that are sicker that really can't be dealt with in some of the smaller hospitals around us. It's our mission.
And for those who've been paying attention, 54, again, is a number that we've been at now for a while.
We really haven't changed much, and on the regional hospital numbers, it's down a little bit again today.
Okay. We had mentioned there was going to be another journal club this week, virtual journal club, being led by Dr. Andy Coates. We believe the presenters today include Dr. David Pallett and Greg Wu. I think, Fred, the topic is respiratory and treatment for.
Right, really the full spectrum of treatment from nasal cannula all the way through intubation and ventilation. So it's really covering all the different techniques we can use to treat patients with respiratory failure with COVID. Mm-hmm. It should be very interesting.
Yeah. So if we learn anything tonight, we'll certainly bring that back again
tomorrow.
Let's talk about some numbers for our workforce here. I think it's important to remind ourselves that we've re-engineered in some ways the way in which our workforce is deployed. Forgive me while I look down here. We currently have approximately 1,100 people who are working from home, who were not working from home at the beginning of the pandemic. That means that they wake up each day and they put a full work day in at home working on computers and doing work here. And we think that they're still as productive as they were before.
In many areas as productive and sometimes even a little bit more productive.
A second category are people who have been strategically redeployed. So the space in which they normally work, often a clinical area, it may not be up and running today. It may be an area where we've closed it for a short period of time, but those workers are still essential workers, and so we send them to other places in the hospital, and we currently have 228 doing what types of jobs, Fred?
All kinds of things, Dennis. So as our employees walk in, we're doing temperature checks and symptom monitoring. Some of them have been redeployed to help with business analytics, depending on what their experience is. So lots of different things around the house.
Then we have a third category of workers that are home doing what's called standby leave. We've talked about this a couple times, but to remind our workforce and those who also listen to these videos, these are people, these are our employees, these are essential employees, but currently they're at home, full pay, full benefits, and they're able to come back to work here within 24 hours if we call them as the volume goes up, but they're not here on this campus. And there's 213 of those today.
That's right, 213. And they do rotate a little bit. So as many as 600 of our employees have cycled through that standby leave process.
Let's talk about why that's important. Last Monday, we had about 420 people in the hospital. Today, we have about 565. So we need to be able to titrate up as the volume goes up.
And we've gone up a little bit and down a little bit, and we're back up. And so that standby leave allows us to bring our workforce back quickly as we need them.
And then there's a fourth number, and I don't even have to look down to see this number, and I know you don't either, and that's the number of our employees that currently are furloughed, meaning out without pay from the medical center. And Fred, that number is zero.
Zero.
Yeah, we're very proud of that, and we're certainly working very hard to try to keep nobody furloughed at this time.
That is absolutely what we're trying to do, Dennis.
Talking about workforce, we spoke yesterday about it being National Mental Health Month. We talked about the stress that the pandemic is putting on everybody, how it's normal for people to feel anxiety. And we wanted to talk a little bit more about the resources that are available to our workforce here, either through our EAP program or through HR.
And actually, attached to the email that's going to go out with the link for this video is going to be a Q&A from HR talking about a number of things that people have brought up. So questions about standby leave and testing and those kinds of things, but also some questions about supports that are available, including EAP, the numbers in there for people who need to access it. As we said yesterday, take advantage. If you're feeling stressed, don't bottle it up. Talk to someone.
And the fact that we're now on day 60 or so of this would suggest that this is obviously not a sprint. It's going to be a long marathon. And so it's important for us to take the time to do it.
For everybody.
I'm sure a lot of people, Fred, are interested in knowing whether or not the waiver that we have submitted has been accepted. Is there any update on our application to start doing what they call elective procedures, what we like to call medically necessary procedures?
So not yet, Dennis. I've had a little back and forth with the Department of Health today, but we don't have a decision yet. But we do have a group working on exactly how we're going to operationalize this, and more to come on that when we hear about the waiver. But they've thought about everything in terms of how we're going to start up.
Can we talk tomorrow in detail on that plan?
Yes. Yeah, we absolutely can. The plan is ready to go. As soon as the state gives us the go-ahead, we're going to be able to start.
Okay. Fred, who rocks?
Albany Med nurses.
Our nurses rock.
And as we love these t-shirts, we do. Yes.
Thank you to Maria for making them. So yes, we talked about this being Nurse Recognition Week. We talked yesterday about a couple nurses who had been recognized as pillars, the highest honor we give our nurses. We have two more we'd like to call out today.
That's right. So the third one is Janet Lipinski. She works in the NICU. Shout out to Janet.
Absolutely. And Jennifer Cross, who works in our CPS unit. That's the unit that deals with heart surgeries and the ECMO population that we've spoken about here. She's one of the nurses who's one of the leaders in that unit. So again, congratulations to Jennifer. And I think we have another one or two that we'll talk about later this week as well.
Yep.
Finally, Fred, I got a card in the mail today. And this is from, speaking of nurses, this is from the SICU nurses. And there was one who made these little angels. And she says they're handing them out. And they are watchful protectors. So I already put mine on my my ID to carry around. They're watchful protectors as a way to unite us during this time. And so I think you have a couple of grandchildren, so I'll give those to you. But I thought that was very generous of the SICU nurses to send them to me. And the goal is to try to spread the joy, so I give those to you. And it's a great message from our SICU nurses, another great group.
Thank you very much.
All right, so I think that's it today. Yes. We'll be back again tomorrow. We're going to provide an update on hopefully the waiver as well as the process to do the preoperative testing. We'll have some more updates on our nurse workforce. And that'll do it. So we ask you once again, please take care of yourself, take care of each other, and we'll see you tomorrow.